나 그룹 수라고 생각했는데.
Good morning, we are group number one, and welcome to our presentation. Our group member is Choi Jin-woo and Choi Tae-min, Ki Bi-min, and Im Tae-kyun. Today we brought a topic about the assessment of appropriacy on BPO industry in Vietnam and Philippines. If you have any questions, please wait until the end of our presentation. We have a Q&A time. Then let's start with our contents. First, I will give a definition of what is BPO industry. Then Ki-min and Tae-min will discuss about what country is more fit to the BPO industry and compare the country's risk and the benefit of each country. Finally, Tae-kyun will wrap up our presentation with the conclusion and Q&A. The purpose of this presentation is to choose one country among Vietnam and Philippines to start a business as a company. The business is that our company is planning to do in this field of BPO industry. So what is BPO industry? BPO means business process outsourcing. It's a subset of outsourcing that involves the contracting of the operation and responsibilities of a specific business process as a third-party service provider, like a call center. Then Tae-min will tell you about the information about the Vietnam.
Okay, hi, my name is Choi Tae-min, and now I'm going to talk about Vietnam. So Vietnam is the suitable place to invest in BPO industry. Nowadays, Vietnam trying to improve their level of education or some kind of education. So according to the year 2015, according to Cushman and Wakefield, Vietnam came to the first place from the previous year among the other country in Southeast Asia. So Vietnam have three strengths of in BPO industry. So first one is high education. As I said that Vietnam trying to improve high education. And they also make some university can maybe a youngster can educate it by high quality education in institute. And also they provide lower labor costs. So if you want to invest or business with Vietnam, you can hire worker to cheaper than other countries in Southeast Asia. And also the government trying to develop on human resource. So you can use human resource. So nowadays, world suffers some recession, and also U.S. and Europe has some risk about currency or economy. So
wait, if you show.
So future outlook. So each government department in Vietnam is due to expand the investments on system development for the next 5 years in order to meet the global level. So the Vietnam government trying to improve part of education. So and also the most using industries in IT service are infralies, and also information supply, education, and so on. So meanwhile, broadcasting service industry and industries in FSI, such as banks, etc., are planning to extend the investment on IT field. So now I'm talk about risk of Vietnam in BPO industry. Well, nowadays, the world fall into recession of the economy. So Europe has some risk, and also US has some risk. So, but Vietnam has high dependency on exports. So they can damage it to about US risk or Europe risk. So which is more than 8% of Vietnam has high dependency on exports, which is more than 8% of GDP. This structure could easily be affected by the recession of world congestion.
Okay, hello, I'm Quy Minh, and I'm going to introduce the BPO industry in the Philippines. Basically, the Philippines are arising as a leading country of the BPO industry, surpassing the India, the former the leading country. The good things about the Philippines in BPO industry is that it is continuously growing, and it expected to have growth of 40%. However, because of the lack of capital and the technology, they tend to depend on the foreign investment and the capital. So they are very welcoming for the foreign investors to put their money in their markets. That means foreign investors have high possibilities of high returns, and also can expect high returns on their foreign investment. And for example, there are around 60 call centers in Philippines, and they are based on the American capitals. So because their manpower is relatively cheap, and their basic language is English, so they their global they have more strength in global global they have more power in global they have more power than their competitors. So what the future has because of the American and European industries are keep going into the European economies. And they are continuously gains and profits by cost cutting. Nevertheless, the Philippines have some bad disadvantages like security problems, like they have they have political problems Philippines government and the local Muslims, and their bureaucracy is suffering from the corruption, and there are some natural disasters.
And I'll talk about our conclusion by wrapping up our presentation conclusion. So basically, our topic was to choose a country among Vietnam and Philippines to invest in the PR industry. And we went through each country's current status and future outlooks, their advantages and their own risks. So at that point, all of us were not sure which country to choose because both of them were highly appropriate in the BPO industry. However, as you can see, we chose Philippines as our country to invest because of these many five reasons, and some of them were already explained by Queenie. So firstly, it is expected to have around 40% growth rate in BPO industry. Also, Kimin said earlier, Philippines are highly dependent on foreign investors, so they are highly open-minded to foreigners, so we can take advantage from it by in the area of lowering the barrier to entry in the country. Also, various policies, laws, and social institutions from Philippines are highly influenced by America, which are quite familiar to us as a Korean company. Next is cheaper costs. In this area, like I said before, they are highly dependent on foreign investors. We can take advantage from it by, because we have more power as a foreign investor, we can lower the cost and expenses. Finally, which is the most important reason why we chose Philippines, is that because the liquidity of foreign currency exchange and capital. Being flexible means that liquidity means that the more liquidity we are more flexible. It means that we are more flexible. So it makes us easier to do business in that country. And that's the end of our presentation. Do you have any questions?
What about the political and economic risk in the future for two countries?
You mean to Seoul or?
What did you find information about political and economic risk?
Both countries are in the area of corruption. They have higher corruption rates compared to other Southeast Asian countries. However, as the economic grows, the infrastructure will take place and it will stable. We're assuming that it will stable the corruption rate.
Okay, and then what about facts and figures? You gave some information here, like the labor cost is low and so on. But do you have any facts and figures?
About?
For example, labor costs, how much is the labor cost in average industrial wage or comparing the labor cost of two countries?
So give us a second. So we didn't include it in the reports. We have the information, but we didn't include it.
General idea about it.
We just put the general idea.
You mean, is it in your written report?
No, we changed, we have evaluated a report. It was in our previous report, but we changed it, so it's not in the report. But if you want the actual numbers, we can give you after the class.
Okay, thank you.
Should we start?
Hi, hello, my name is Yu Sang-ho, and our group will be presenting about the various cases of currency crisis around the world. So, we'll talk about the currency crisis in Greece, South Korea in 1997, Russia in 1998, and how countries deal with crisis when currency crisis occurs. And last week, we'll also talk about how countries can prevent such crises. So we'll move on to the first part, the currency crisis of Greece.
Hello, my name is Mata. I will explain Greece crisis. The causes of Greece crisis can be explained by many factors. Essentially, Greek government reason for risk crisis is amount of Greek government debts and used to Greece used to Europe, they have lost ability to cover these crises, and they started wrong policies. Greece economy were more depressed. Greece promise. I will explain that detail. First problem is import using euro to Greece. First. Greece economy growth depend on low interest rate with use of euro in this situation, the interest rate, if the interest rate fair than inflation rate, that inflation rate, that then that that can lead to rate can decrease a real rate of interest and decreased trade balance. Okay. And second problem is vicious circles of risk. As mentioned earlier, inflation is dipped. If inflation is dipped, the ability of exporting is weaker. So that is can lead to increased with the tax and also lead to lead consumer to decrease consumer to cannot consume consume of their money and that and that lead to consumer to not spend their money and eventually making the companies leave the country. As company were leaving space, unemployment rates skyrocket and disability increase to repay their debt as tax income decreased dramatically. So as a result, the vicious circle was repeated at once. The graph shows present situation of Greece. Greece has debt at 300 billion euros. This part is a solution. Presently, solution they have there many. Okay, so first solution is exist erosion or crisis, and second solution is negotiate bailout. Greece means that Greece can reduce the rationally some rationally and rationally and launched originated currency is drachma, but this solution was oversighted by some several problems, opposite several problems like initially debit, relief, closer relations with Europe. Greece could also agree to. The proposed solution about the crisis is Brexit and bailout.
Greek economy can recover from the several recession by exiting the Eurozone and launching a new nation policy, the drachma. However, the proposal co-cited several problems like additional debt relief, closer relation with Europe. Greece could also read traditional bailout funds and debt relief in exchange for privatizing certain government-owned business and selling government-owned assets. The solution practice or plans to the future. Thank you.
I would like to talk about South Korea currency crisis in 1990. And let's see our content, table of content. I present in this order. Let's see the first content. Before currency crisis, Korea implemented rigid floating exchange rate system. It made exchange rate be stable. So we can see that before currency crisis, it looked stable. And some major companies overinvested facilities. And the graph showed that there were a lot of companies which had a lot of liability. And banks in Korea took out a loan from foreign countries and loaned major companies a lot of money. They took advantage of low interest rate in other countries to take a loan from a foreign country based on low interest. Based on same exchange rate system. Unless any problem emerges, this system would work well. However, after dumping of talent, the foreign investors started to withdraw their money rapidly. Thailand economy also depended on low interest foreign capital. And because of rapid withdrawing of foreign investors, companies in Korea needed money to repay a loan, but they invested that liquid assets, so they have no alternative but filed for bankruptcy. And this caused weakness of banks. And banks in Korea had to buy a dollar to repay a loan, but there was not enough foreign currency in Korea, so demanding of dollar and interest rate increased so high. After currency crisis, Korea government had not enough dollar, so they left rigid floating exchange rate system and we can see that dollar increased twice against one. And KOSPI decreased rapidly. Finally, Korea requested IMF direct loan and accepted their conditions. So Korea government made labor market be more flexible and implemented a high interest rate policy, and this is Korea currency crisis, and next presenter presents about Russia.
I'd like to talk about Russia's crisis in 1998. First, the content is first the cause and the Russia's crisis. The second, the cost and the crisis. Thirdly, the effect in other countries, what happened after the Russian crisis and after the moratorium. The cause of Russia's crisis can be divided into three parts. First is the insignificant tax system. Second, the international oil price declined, and low credibility due to Asia's currency crisis. The first crisis started in October 1997 up to February 1998. At that time, the Russia's financial market was unstable. This also caused Asia's currency crisis. And secondly, because of the Asian currency crisis, causing panic in the stock markets. The second crisis is the international oil price declined. Russia's export is once again sell oil to other countries. However, because the price is declining, the terms of trade worsened and their financials was lost. And the second, the Russian ruble devaluation. So the ruble went down and the stocks, bond, and the currency collapsed once again. Sorry. The Russia's council's overcoming, Russia council made the overcoming the crisis program, but it was refused. So people felt suspicious about the Russian government, which made another people didn't believe in Russia, so it was a negative effect. And also against the stock collapsed again, like in the graph, it went up right here, but after this situation, it went down again. So in the effect on other countries, Ukraine's foreign exchange reserve went decreased due to Russia. Poland's stock price went 37% down, which is a huge cost. And due to Russia's bonds in Europe, almost $50 billion was Russia's bonds. But because Russia made the moratorium, which is also another also like a default, they couldn't pay back the bonds, which made Europe banks great loss. Especially Deutsche Bank credibility rate went extremely down. It was AAA, but went to AA+. After the moratorium, they fixed the change rate. They reversed fixed change rates. But after the currency crisis and the moratorium, they changed to the floating exchange system. Also, there was a lot of corrupt, and also the tax system was bad. So they made economic reform to make their economy better. And finally, they improved their investment environment for other foreigners to invest in their country. Thank you. And we'll talk about the coping crisis.
So far we've talked about various cases of countries facing currency crisis, but we still didn't talk about how countries deal with such crisis. And so I'll talk about how countries can deal with such crisis by giving an example of Korea and Malaysia, and explain about effects of crisis and what is right when dealing with currency crisis. So before we get to the main point, we should focus on the 1997 crisis in Asia, which affected South Korea, Thailand, Malaysia, and Philippines, and Indonesia, so on. But I'll focus on South Korea and Malaysia, because South Korea and Malaysia faced the same crisis, but they managed to deal with it differently, in a very different way. So to begin with, Korea, as we explained before, received aid from others, such as aid from IMF or IBRD. But the problem was that it wasn't exactly an aid, it was just a debt given to Korea. So in a nutshell, Korea converted the currency crisis into physical crisis. So they managed to solve the currency crisis by adding another problem, which is fiscal crisis. So when we explain how Korea solved the problem, I'll focus on how they deal with fiscal crisis. So what they did was they they maintained a high interest rate and they made a retrenched finance, which decreased the demand in Korea, giving surplus to government financial states and helping the Korean government to pay for the debts they made from IMF and IBRD. But in the case of Malaysia, Malaysia refused such aid from IMF and IBRD, and by doing so, they made an independent policy such as capital control and fixed currency rate. So they made their own policy, unlike Korea, because Korea was dependent on IMF's instructions, but Malaysia tended to act on their own. And so by doing so, they managed to solve their problems, but in a slower way compared to Korea. So what is the effect of the currency crisis on both Korea and Malaysia? So to begin with, Korea faced a problem with hot money. Hot money is a short-term currency investment from foreign investors, which makes the country's economy unstable. And so Korea's economy faced some fragile situations since 1997, making them fragile to foreign investment. And in case of foreign investment, we cannot overlook Malaysia, because Malaysia faced a serious problem with foreign investment, because foreign investment fell dramatically after 1997 because of their long-term solutions. And in case of domestic economy, we already talked about it, I'll skip it. So we talked about these two countries, how these two countries solve the problem, and so you're wondering what is right and what is wrong with the two countries. So to begin with, in the case of Korea, we can say that they solved the bubble with the bubble. A bubble, a currency crisis, and another bubble, which is physical crisis. So they actually made another problem. And when Korea was paying the price for their debt, it is obvious that Korea's government and companies made all the mistakes, but it was the Korean people that had to pay the price for what was done wrong by the country and the companies of Korea. And on the other hand, in the case of Malaysia, as I talked before, they faced a serious problem with foreign investment because they decreased dramatically, but they were able to stabilize their economy compared to Korea Korea focused only on solving the problems quickly, but in the case of Malaysia, they looked much further than Korea, and this made their economy much more stable than Korea, even to this day. So the best solution of currency crisis is not getting a currency crisis. So I'll talk about how countries can prevent, but actually there's not many solutions to prevent a currency crisis, because if there was such thing, Greece, Russia, Korea, Malaysia wouldn't have faced such currency crisis. So the best solution I can give is just a stabilized economy and preventing short-term capital flows among the country's currency market. So this is our end of our presentation, and we will receive some questions.
So there's no time for questions because the time limit was 12 minutes, but I think your presentation is more than 20 minutes. Okay, so please be aware of the time when you do the presentation. Okay, you know what I need.